adama aluma lumale ibn adama wa jannatu jannati
ibn adama aluma lumale ibn adama wa jannatu jannati
ibn adama aluma lumale ibn adama wa jannatu jannati.
God is love. God is lovable. The face of God is magnificence. That translates, radiates into his representative on earth. That is the Khalifa. And that is what makes, that creates that natural attraction, because the Khalifa and any other person that he meets. And that's what how people react when they see what they love. When they see the Khalifa Tulmasi rain or shine, they would flock to him. Some will flock and cross the road, careless of whether he's knocked down by a car or what. At that time, he doesn't even know there is a street meant for cars. He wants to cross over and get to his beloved one. It's just like the case of the firefly, the moth that we talk of, and then the candle and the glow of the candle. Love is the attractive ingredient here.
Anytime I come to the airport here, some thoughts and memories come back to me. The fact that this airport has been blessed with the presence of a Khulafai who have visited this country. The third Khalifa Hazrat Khilafat Tulmasi, Hazrat Nasir Ahmed, was here, and where I'm standing is the place through which he descended to meet the thousands of Ahmadi Muslims who had come all over the country to welcome their spiritual leader.
For well over 50 or 60 years, people had only heard of Khalifa, but they had never seen one. And so people were really yearning to see one. So naturally, if you are told that a man of that stature is coming, and you will have the opportunity not only to see him, but to touch him, I mean, you can imagine. It is not something that can be described in words.
For some of us, seeing the Khalifa descend, you know, from the aeroplane was an experience that you could not describe. For some of us who had not seen the Khulafa before, it was an experience that was most touching. And for some of us who were working close to the protocol, our nearness to the Khalifa was very, very, you know, evoked memories that were very, very inspiring.
People were in absolute ecstasy, because that was the very first time any Khalifa had set foot on this country.
The reporters could not understand the sort of link that Ahmadi Muslims have for their Khulafa. They were amazed to see Ahmadis coming on their way, and they're chanting, Nare Takbir, Allahu Akbar, Nare Takbir. They were not mere, you know, chants. but it flowed from the depth, the inner depth of their hearts and belief in the fact that the Khulafa is a representative of Allah on this earth.
We introduced an umbrella. You know, it's a symbol of the kings of our country. It doesn't matter whether it's raining or shining, but there must be a type of thing. The government of Ghana in those days was also very helpful because the community itself did not have that much of assets, but they gave us a vehicle. They brought a Mercedes Benz. Didn't belong to the mission, it belonged to the government. Then they brought us motorcycle riders who would, you know, escort Huzu to wherever he would go.
I remember a friend, an Ahmadi friend, once told me, "Your Khalifas are wonderful people." I said, "How and why?" So you remember the third Khalifa came here. I was in Solpon to greet him. As I approached him in his front, my heart fell down. I tried to bend and Huzu picked it up, and my Khalifa picked it and put it on my head. Lo and behold, that was the year I had the opportunity to go to Hajj. He is a really wonderful man, a man of God. And so he has that feeling that these Khulafa, we may not be accepting Ahmadiyyat, but these are true God, men from God, who are sent by God, raised for the benefit of mankind. And so whatever they do it with true devotion and love for the people. And he is the one who introduces the motto for the Jamaat, love for all, hatred for none, and other subsequent Khulafa, the Rabi and Khamis, have been following the same motto. Come to talk of the love of the Khalifa. I think the proudest Ahmadis you can find in the world are Ahmadi Muslims of Ghana.
I made sure that he was given a rousing welcome in Techiman. The welcome was such that the people of Techiman said it even surpassed the time when Nkrumah, the president of Ghana, used to go there. We had been told that he is very, very elderly, and so we must be, you know, very careful about the program. It should not be lengthy, and, you know, and things like that. Completely. The moment he sees the Jamaat, you know, he becomes more than a youth. And here was somebody who would shake hands with everybody, despite the fact that there are hundreds and sometimes thousands. He started his speech that he delivered in Urdu. Then he turned it to Arabic. Then he turned it into English. Then finally he spoke a few words in her language. I can tell you the emotions that were moving within him. He couldn't decide on the language to use to convey those emotions to the people of Techiman. And it was an emotional thing. The people who met him were so much inspired that the takbirs that we received in Techiman on that day, I don't think that from that time, if I were to count, I would be able to count them.
Better for none, for Islam stand for peace.
I came to Ghana when we were in Rabwa. And when he went back, the amount of love, the sort of love he showed to us baffled everybody. Our colleagues in the Jamia started envying us. Always call us, where are his children? Where are his children?
His coming was a blessing for us in that he had mentioned and inspired us that God wants him to take Ahmadiyya to another level. And therefore, he, through inspiration of Allah, is going to establish the Nusra Jahan Live Forward Scheme, which started in 1971 with the establishment of hospitals from which funding was made to support the schools that offer education to the Ghanaian populace.
When a Khalifa comes to a country, the leap of the community is 50 years ahead, at least. Because look, if the first Khalifa had not set up the schools and the hospitals, the Ghana Jamaat would not have had the image that we have today. The impact of a school and the impact of a hospital, which is a symbol of service to the people, is something that cannot be equaled by any other way.
As if they had, you know, programmed. You know, they started with education. I mean, secondary school here and there, that's Nusra Jahan. That was to be followed by hospitals. You know, and you can't imagine, presently, if you go to any place where a hospital is, it's the best patronized hospital in anywhere.
We met the then head of state. We told him that he would come from Sorbonne very late. The following morning he would be going, and he would want to see you, so how do we manage it? So, even if he comes at 12 o'clock in the night, I'll be waiting for him. That's what happened. He told him that for a country to develop, first you need education, you need roads, you must link every city with a village in this country, and you need telecommunications.
My concern is not only with the Ahmadis in Africa, but with Africa itself. I'm a religious leader who believes in total dedication to the cause of Allah, and if you are honest in that dedication, then you must be dedicated to His creation. I'm training and instructing my community according to the best education and teachings in Islam, that is to say, serve the cause of humanity, just for the love of it.
When Huzur Rabi was coming, it was as if the whole nation is coming from outside and people are to receive them. Come and see the people, the thousands of them, thronging the airport to catch a glimpse of that spiritual person who leads the Ahmadiyya community, and see the Ahmadis from all corners of the country line up at the airport with their flags, with their handkerchief, in their white attire.
him to the reception, and they interviewed him. Certainly, these are very wonderful people, you know, to accost. They are very, very wonderful, because every question that is put to them, they answer almost automatically, you know, with a lot of sense. You know, so we were just glued to our seat.
Africa, in my opinion, is a very important continent. Its importance is emerging with the passage of time, and the whole world is now compelled to take note of the future rise of Africa. So this is a continent which must not be neglected by any thinking
community.
When Huzoor came here, you know, it seemed as if we were living in a different world. And it is such a wonderful atmosphere. People are chanting Takbir, Allahu Akbar, Hazrat Khalifa Tumasi, Zindabad, Ahmadiyya Zindabad, Insaniya Zindabad. You know, and it's as if the whole world has been moved.
He went to the Solpo for the conference. You know, throughout the life of the Jamaat, the conference was used also as a means of raising funds. When he attended the Jalsa and saw the way the funding was done, the fund was raised, he called me, and at the time we also had the president, and he said, look, we are putting a stop to this now. So we said, look, if we put a stop to it, how are we going to run the community? That's the way. He said, look, there is a way in the community which is universally accepted. That is to give chanda and give receipts so that, and so that is what we are going to do.
It was a big shock. How then are we going to generate funds for the Jamaat? Huzoor told Amisa, you don't worry. Anything that falls short, you ask me, inshallah ta'ala, with Allah's grace, I'll make the provision. So we didn't feel any shortfall at all.
Now, that was a revolutionary thing, I can tell you. Because in truth, nobody had ever believed that the community could be run like that. It was after he had stopped that and had put us into the chanda collection that we realized that if we continued with that, the community would have completely collapsed financially, because there was no way we could have raised that amount that we got through chanda. Impossible.
It generated that spirit of devoting something, parting something for the Jamaat. And since then, alhamdulillah, things have been going on well, because Huzoor, when he directed us to pay the 160 instead of collecting funds at the Jalsa, was a prayer for us, was a blessing, and the writing on the right guidance, and we have been living with it.
When it comes to Tahrik Jadid contributions, when it comes to Waqf Jadid contributions in Africa here, when it comes to Chanda Am, we'll see it. What the Ahmadi, the Ghanaian Ahmadi, always keeps in mind, the first thing he asks himself is, oh, will we be able to meet the expectation of the Khalifatul Masih? Because the Khalifatul Masih is so particular about us.
As they come to the country, they begin to perceive the line of action to take, what will bring in more harmony, what will bring in better administration, what will make the community prosperous and also dynamic. And that is why I've always believed that if a Khalifa comes to a country, he gives you 50 years leap forward. Because otherwise you will sit here and you will never know anything. and you'll be doing things the usual way, the way you did it.
When I go there with an open mind, then so many things begin to appear to me, so many areas which were previously unexplored automatically come to my mind, where I find we could serve.
The fourth Khalifa came when we had military regime. One thing that he did was to give counsel to the military regime. You know, it's difficult to talk to the to a military regime, but he felt that here is a country which he loved. He has his members, he wants them to prosper. But there are certain things which need to be put right. And it remains words. He said, look, first and foremost, you have a country. And you have people who are learned, who can contribute to the development of the country. Simply because, as you know, a people, they feel that they are not very secure here. So they have all left for other countries. How would you develop a country like that if you are not going to embrace them so that they will use the knowledge and expertise that they have to do what they need to do for the development of the country? And at a certain stage, tears came from his eyes. The man saw that he was very much moved, and he pledged. He said, if you go back to London, all the Ghanaians in London, any of them who wants to come back to Ghana, if he comes in your name, I guarantee that when he arrives here, no harm will be done here. Now, this is something of very high resolve. You don't generally go to a country and convince the people of the rulers of the country to do what is best for the country.
I have come here to see my loved ones, the community of the Ahmadiyya movement. I am so much moved and overwhelmed that I can't say much today.
Having known him in Ghana, when he was here as a devotee, we used to visit him. He was like a colleague, a friend. We would go to him, and the way he would serve us, we were amazed that these are the family members of Hazrat Akdas. But see how humble they are in serving us. Well, through God's divine grace, this humble personage was elevated to the status of Khalifatul Masih. And we felt that we are part of him because he's a brother to us. As he would put it, he's a Ghanaian.
We have lived with a Khalifa before he became a Khalifa. We feel he is one of us, and he's adequately demonstrated to the whole world that he is one of us.
When I was here, I did not think of abandoning this country. I considered myself to be a Ghanaian.
He comes to Ghana. Imagine somebody who has lived among us for many, many years. This time round, he comes as a Khalifa.
The British Airways flight, which brought him, His Holiness, to Ghana, would normally be landed out there. But we have this reserved area. It's reserved exclusively for president.
I remember I had an exam in school the following day. But the anxiety I had to see Wuzu. Arriving in Ghana was so great that I couldn't just imagine myself relaxing.
People who were with Huzur in this plane were not Ahmadis. When they looked through the windows, when the plane had landed, and they haven't gotten down yet, and they could see thousands of people, thousands of line just close to the tarmac to where there is the lounge is, across the road, and they could see about 2 miles of people winding through from the airport. We said, ah. But who, these people are coming to meet who?
Finally, when the aircraft was about to land, we all started shouting, la, ila, ila, la, oh, Muhammad Rasulullah.
The moment he came out from the plane, I mean, it was like a big thunderous, you know, rain. Everybody spontaneously, you know, shouted, Allahu Akbar, you know, Nabi Takbir, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar.
You just couldn't control your emotions. You could hear the takbir, the Allahu Akbar. It was incredible.
It was out of the world. People were beside themselves, first with ecstasy and also with wonder. And he was giving a rousing welcome.
The kind of light I saw in his face, I have never seen it anywhere.
I was so filled with that happiness and the joy in my heart that I couldn't just stop the tears from running all over my face.
The crowds were such that at times we couldn't control them. The government sent policemen, security men, you know, to come and guide us. I mean, they come and then they tell us, they say, but we were useless here. And those people are so organized. They have their own soldiers. They have their own policemen. He's talking of Khudam al-Ahmadiyya, who were there to keep order and keep everything in check. He said, but what are we doing here? They don't need us. But that is the face of Ahmadiyya. And that is the beauty of Khilafat.
People have seen their Khalifa, the man that they love. They want to see him, they want to come to him. But at the same time, I had to ensure that nothing happens to the man. We have to ensure his protection. So I was torn between, you know, not injuring people's feeling and also ensuring that people didn't go overboard. And that was a very, you know, interesting experience that I went through at the time. But the man is such a man that if you see him once, you would love to see him again. Even his facial expression alone was something that will entice you to want to see him again.
When he came, La Ilah was being sung. I stood at post and I was shedding tears. I couldn't imagine myself. I was too much heavy on my post. So at the point that I was laughing at myself, look at you, you're a security person, how come you are crying like this, you see? But I understood what my grandfather was telling me. I could feel that this is a man of God who has come. Indeed, I know that Allah Almighty has planted a lot of love in our hearts.
The Supreme Leader was getting closer, walking closer. You know, because they were lined across the perimeter, anyone who shook hands or came close, I mean, you could see the excitement on their face as if it was a dream, a lifetime dream had come true, and I could sense their happiness. Even not being a Muslim or an Ahmadi, I got into the excitement of the day. I say, my God, I've lived another day. If even that day, after that day, I'm gone,
my children will know the story of the visit of Huzur, and they will pray for me, because here is a humble servant of Islam whose humility and service has been acknowledged by the Khulafa, and here Huzur is embracing me with prayers that I should continue to serve the cause of Ahmadiyya. It's just wonderful.
It was the senior government official, presidency, chief of staff, who were most anxious. They made sure that nothing went wrong. So they were always in touch to make sure that things were properly done and that he had had the best reception. And believe you, being the office of the spokesperson of the president, he was here to receive the Huzur on behalf of the president.
I had the distinguished honor of being asked by the president to come and receive the Supreme Leader. And I was very excited about it. We felt that he was one of us. Most Ghanaians feel him to be a Ghanaian because he spent so much of his time in Ghana, traveling around the country.
Our beloved spiritual leader, Hazrat Mirza Masroor Ahmed Khalifat al-Masih V, the supreme head of the worldwide Ahmadiyya Muslim community, to Ghana.
It was a scene that I think it's once in a lifetime how I felt, even though I have seen Huzur on TV, you know, the way I felt when I saw him here in Ghana waving us, it was so magical.
Thanks be to Allah and for His favors that the annual convention of Jamaat Ahmadiyya Ghana is commencing today.
When Huzur comes here, or the Khulafa came here, they gave us the spirit, they increased our spirit of dedication. And he urged us, Ahmadis should be devoted in their prayers, in their worship. We should serve humanity. And all of us are doing our best to our neighbors, to our people, at our workplaces, wherever we are. And so these are the spirits that when they come, we feel that when they speak, they are speaking to our heart, and as if it is God telling us. So we are happy that we are hearing a voice coming from God through the Khulafa. That's whenever we hear them on the telly or physically when we meet them, we don't know how we feel. We feel we are in a different level of spiritual elevation.
I congratulate you, for you have fulfilled your allegiance to Khilafat. But remember that when two persons love each other, Satan always tries to cause rifts and cracks in that relationship. This relationship of love only be safeguarded by continuing to seek the help of Allah. In fact, this bond of love that exists between the Khalifa and the Jamaat is due to the love for the promised Messiah alayhi salam. And the love for the promised Messiah alayhi salam is because of love for the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And the love for the Holy Prophet is due to the love for Allah the Almighty. So bowing before Him when we seek the help of Allah, who is the master of the earth and heaven, who created everything in the universe, who is the provider and sustainer of everything, seeking His help, conscious that we are knit as a single unit, no Satan can cause rift in our relationship.
Some people in Pakistan were saying that Hazrat Khalifat al-Masih has opened Arafah for the Jamaat in Ghana. But indeed, the number of people who came, the fact that everybody was in white, it's a sign of happiness. Ghana, when you put on white, it's a sign of happiness. The speeches and the comportment of the people. And whenever he came out from the place, we made sure the umbrella was on so that people would know that he is our king. And we bear allegiance to him.
He also gives certain directives. And those directives, we have tried to implement them. And people ask me that when you became the saddle, there has been so much change in the Majlis Udamul Ahmadiyya. And I say it in my head that you don't know the secret behind it. Because Wuzu's directives is not because I am doing so well or I am a better person than those who served before my term. But just because at the time Wuzu came, the directives that he gave, I was fortunate to be the one who implemented those decisions. And that there is no advice or directive that will come from the Wuzu and you will try to implement it and will not bring improvement.
Wuzu has been urging us that we can be the number one Jamaat Ahmadiyya in Africa. He believes we can. So on all occasions, he will urge us, oh Ghana, you can do more than you have done.
If today all people begin to work hard, the pace of progress of this country would increase many folds. So you who are Ahmadi Muslims and to whom the true light of the teaching of Islam has reached, work with this philosophy in mind and draw the attention of others to this objective, and that we must excel in every work.
We had government officials led by the president himself, and then the paramount chiefs, then the national chief imam for the non-Ahmadi Muslims throughout the country. He was there. The cardinal, who is known as the prince of the Pope, he was present. We didn't leave anybody behind. The president, he sat throughout the session. Not that the president has come and delivered his lecture and gone, no. Sat there throughout the session.
In Ghana, successive leaders of the Ahmadiyya community have launched various schemes for the betterment of their members and indeed the nation as a whole.
I believe the central purpose of religion must be the betterment of humanity. So when I meet a spiritual leader like that, showing the concern, the exceptional concern for humanity, not just his following, and I say, ah, that's a leader worth following. Even if I'm not an Ahmadi, there's something I feel, a vibration, a vibe that links me with him. And he prayed for me. He prayed for me.
Long live Khilafat. Long live.
People have attested to it that whenever the Khilafat had prayed for them, Allahu Akbar, they have had progress in their personal life, in their businesses, and everything that they requested for.
At the time, I knew Wuzu was coming, arriving in Ghana in April. But before his arrival, I was involved in the accident, and I was in Kolebu in the hospital. So I could not go to the airport to meet Wuzu. 5 of my ribs were broken, my spine got damaged, so I was paralyzed in all 4 limbs. I was suffering from pneumonia. At the same time, I'm diabetic. And the doctors claimed that there were cracks on my skull. So there was no hope for me. And I said they would not even attend to me. They were not attending to me. Even at one point in time, they would take me to the theater. After a whole day, they would bring me back. They would not operate on me, with the excuse that there was no need actually doing any operation on me. But before I was taken home, Amir had ensured that at least I was brought to the mission house for Huzur to pray for me. Huzur entered my ambulance. I recognized him. The whole ambulance was brightened, and I saw him, and I appreciated, yes, this is Huzur I'm meeting. And I was myself so happy about it. Deep down me, I was so happy. Some rejuvenation went through my whole soul. And it gave me hope, especially when he spoke with me. He spoke to me and said that, inshallah. He mentioned my name, Alhaji Muhyiddin, inshallah, you will be okay. And I remember when I went to Jalsa 2 years back, that was in 2010, when I returned from the US and attended Jalsa in 2010, he asked me, he was fast enough to recall what he told me in the ambulance. That, can I still remember what he told me when I was, I said yes, and I was also able to recount it.
He went to places where no other Khalifa had been.
Wherever he went, people would want to follow him to the schools, Potsin, Esachir, and to Kumasi. The non-Ahmadis, even the police servicemen who were asked to be on the escort, they say, wow, here is a spiritual leader that we want to dedicate our time for.
In my life, I've never seen any personality coming to Ghana here that will attract people so much like the way Huzur was. And everybody was sort of wanted to see, and you see the people were so enthused, they were so much committed that they want to do everything just to see Huzur. And really, when Huzur came, you can't imagine, the place was totally charged.
When we went to some of the places in the regions, those who were not Ahmadis, they are not Muslims. When they see him, you've never seen, I recall very well that in the central region, one woman, upon seeing Huzur, he commented that, hey, is it also the same human being as we are human beings? Why is it that he is so a different person altogether from all human beings? So for somebody who is not even an Ahmadi to distinguish the personality of Huzur from ordinary members is something that is quite remarkable.
Wherever Huzur made a visit, the people say, yes, here is my opportunity. Let me show humility, let me show homage, let me serve Khilafat Ahmadiyya. And so throughout our institutions, the mission proper, and our schools, even those who were non-Ahmadis, they said there's an opportunity to meet Huzur. Even by touching his hand or seeing his face, it's a blessing for me because his radiant face is a prayer for us.
It's been a long time that we've seen our beloved Imam. And when we hear that he was coming to Kumasi to come with us, we were very, very, very happy.
When they saw Huzur's convoy coming, everybody was trying to get a glimpse of Huzur, so we had to stay very strong. So we had a wall stretching from that end, coming down towards the mission house.
Members of Council of Ulama, on the non-Ahmadi Muslim side. They were lined up, and then some chiefs of the Zongo community, they were lined up. And one of them said, this is a holy personality, it's better we pray behind them. We were so happy because hardly will you see non-Ahmadi that caliber, that ulama caliber, to say they are praying behind Ahmadis. So we let them, although they showed some kind of character, we let them to their prayers. And it was so surprising when Tafsir and Co saw them, they had to vacate their sitting place and then gave it to them.
Anti-ahmadi in Ghana today understands what is a khalifa, what does Khilafat mean, but they envy us. Unfortunate thing is that they don't have it, and they cannot have it, and they don't have the guts to talk of having a khalifa. But otherwise, they know what it is. And when Huzur comes here, the non-Ahmadi leaders, they keep requesting us to book appointment for them, for some of them just to come and have a handshake with Huzur. They do. They call you on phone, they send people to us that, oh, I just want to meet the Khalifa, I just want to meet the Khalifa, I just want to meet the Khalifa. That tells you what a Khalifa means to them. Otherwise, why do you want to meet him?
I saw a certain man who, to me, wasn't an Ahmadi. So I contacted him, and to find out why he was here, he said, I heard so many things about this leader of yours. So I came here to just see, have a glimpse of him. And by seeing him, I realized that this is not an ordinary person. I think this should be a man of God. And to me, that statement from the man, you know, made me proud as an Ahmadi.
I was then 12 years. When we heard Huzu was coming here, we were just here. We heard songs of praise in Urdu. It was amazing.
When he entered from the gate, immediately he got out from his car. He stopped, listened to us whilst we were singing. He stood there for a while and listened to the song. He was surprised.
Huzu was also impressed to see us singing in Urdu.
That time when we just saw him, I mean, we were very happy. When they started singing the takbir, we were just, responding. We were very happy. We were young at that time. We didn't know anything. But the way the elder people were happy, we knew that he was just a spiritual leader.
That time we heard of Huzu. We saw his pictures. We didn't know Huzu. Who is he? We've seen his picture. So the first time we saw him, the first time I saw him, I was very happy. I was very happy, very, very happy.
God is love. God is lovable. The face of God is magnificence. That translates, radiates into his representative on earth. That is the Khalifa. And that is what makes, that creates that natural attraction, because the Khalifa and any other person that he meets. And that's what how people react when they see what they love. When they see the Khalifa Tulmasi rain or shine, they would flock to him. Some will flock and cross the road, careless of whether he's knocked down by a car or what. At that time, he doesn't even know there is a street meant for cars. He wants to cross over and get to his beloved one. It's just like the case of the firefly, the moth that we talk of, and then the candle and the glow of the candle. Love is the attractive ingredient here.
We have a different perception of Khilafat. It is within us, it is for us, it is ours. So it is something that, a treasure that we have to hold dearly, safeguard it, so that it will live long for people even after us.
The whole place was full with people, up to the streets and everywhere. There were people even on top of these buildings, viewing Huzur, shouting and waving their white handkerchiefs for at least for about 10 minutes, the place was just unbelievable. I personally was shocked. Even Amin Saab asked if we were trying to bring the headquarters to Kumasi. So we said, no, Amin Saab, no, we are only complimenting what Accra have done. He said, no, what we are doing is something different. Said, that is the expression of the people's feeling.
We are standing here looking at Zul up there, and he also standing there and waving us like this, that he saw us waving handkerchief, singing. Because how the man is, you can't look at him. He's a very great man.
The speed with which Huzu was walking, Hudam could not even match it. You had to run. Huzu was walking, but as a matter of fact, the Hudam had to run before we could make up. The whole place was charged, and they were just all looking. Because they didn't know what is actually happening, that all Ahmedis have gathered, they've blocked this road, because this is not a road that you can usually block. But under the circumstance, Huzu was coming, and then the road was blocked. Huzu entered the mosque, and I was just standing there, and I held Huzu's sandals. As an Ahmadi, I have the strong conviction that if you're talking about representative of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on this earth, is a Khilafat Masih. So for me to come closer to Khilafat Masih, and he's so blessed a person that even where he steps is full of blessing. So if where he steps, just that that's where he has stepped is full of blessing, then what of the shoes? So I think that holding the shoe, it is just a privilege. It's not, because it's not anybody. So I was so much enthused and I was happy to have held the shoe of no other person than Huzu himself, who is a representative of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Huzu appeared at the top there while everybody was waiting here. And that was definitely one of the most heart-touching and electrifying moments that I have ever witnessed.
After the Zuhur and Asar prayers, we requested Huzu to come up to the balcony to say salam to the Jamaat. So Huzu, we came through this entrance. So as soon as Huzu came here, the members were overwhelmed.
When we saw Huzu like an angel, he's a noble man. He's a nice man. My mom is a Catholic, Roman Catholic. When he hear that Huzu is coming, he'll say, I will go and see your spiritual man. When he see my that man, my mom make happy. Then he said, yes, this man is a spiritual man. I was so amazed to see Huzu. For the first sight, I couldn't look at him. See how wonderful, how special he was. I couldn't look at him. I said, this is the great man.
And the noise was tremendous, huge noise, huge noise. They were shouting together in one voice, and the thunder was great.
The unity with which the members of the Jamaat sang is in itself a clear indication that if there's any one institution that can unite mankind, is Khilafat.
The hadith said, let's have a ham ajennati. I can't say what we saw that day all here. I can't say.
None of those things was planned. Those things that happened in Kumasi, nobody planned anything.
We want to see somebody leading us who is spiritually pure. And if you see a thing like this, certainly nobody will tell you to believe that here is somebody who knows what he's about. And everybody will want to follow people who are spiritually imbued in that way.
Talk about Labeik, what it means is we are here and we are prepared to do your bidding. We consider ourselves as your beloved followers, and we sacrifice ourselves and our hearts and our minds and everything, you know. So we are prepared for whatever you bid us to do.
The Khalifa, well, we know he's for the common man, for the ordinary Ahmadi. When we write to him, he responds. When we speak to him, he accepts. When we ask him for prayers, he prays for us.
I came with an open mind. First of all impelled and motivated by the love of the people. You know, you can't imagine the relationship between Ahmadis and their so-called chief, who is in fact a servant of them, as has been defined by the Holy Prophet of Islam himself. Sayyidul Qawme Khadimuhum. That person who is a true leader of a people has to be their true servant. So our relationship is a mutual master-service relationship, which is oscillating between me and the community in a manner that both want to serve and both are held in high esteem and high respect. So that generates an immense love, which is unseen in the rest of the relationship in the world. So that is why when I go to the people, just looking at them fills my heart with sublime pleasure. And I know the same is happening there.
I was grateful to God Almighty, witnessing the sincerity and loyalty of the new and old Ahmadis. I was overcome by feelings of gratitude and praise for Allah the Almighty. Indeed, I would go so far as to say that your noble feelings that were rich with sincerity and devotion, and that flowed from every face of every child, old, young, man and women, not only created a deep love for you in my heart, but I feel that it conveyed to many Ahmadis living far away countries that should you wish to learn new ways of love and affection for the Khalifa of the age, then learn it from Ghanaian Ahmadis.